Blackstone Audio presents Last Call by Tim Powers. For Gloria Batsford, with heartfelt thanks for more than a decade's worth of help and advice and great dinners and sociable friendship, may we all have many decades more. And with thanks, too, to Chris and Teresa Arena, Mike Autry, Beth Bailey, Luigi Baker, Jim Blaylock, Lou and Myrna Donato, Don Ellison, Mike Gaddy, Russ Galen, Keith Holmberg, Don Johnson, Mike Kelly, Dorothea Kenny, Dana Kunkel, Scott Landry, Jeff Levin, Mark Lipinski, Joe Machuga, Tim McNamara, Steve and Tammy Malk, Dennis Meyer, Phil Pace, Richard Powers, Serena Powers, Randall Robb, Betty Schlossberg, Ed Silberstang, Carlton Smith, Ed and Pat Thomas, and Marv and Carol and Rex Torres. Prologue, 1948, A Castle in the Wasteland. In March of 1951, testifying before the Kefauver Senate Crime Investigating Committee, Virginia Hill stated that Siegel had told her the Flamingo Hotel was upside down, though she was able to cast no light on what he might have meant by that statement. Colin Lepover, Siegel Agonistes. Son, I have seen the good ship sail, keel upward and mast downward in the heavens, and solid turrets topsy-turvy in air. Alfred Lord Tennyson, Idylls of the King. Chapter 1. I'll still have you, sonny boy. Georges Léon held his little boy's hand too tightly and stared up from under his hat brim at the unnaturally dark noon sky. He knew that out over the desert, visible to any motorists along the lonelier stretches of Boulder Highway, the rain would be twisting in tall, ragged funnels under the clouds. Already some flooding had probably crept across the two lanes of Highway 91, islanding the Flamingo Hotel outside town. And on the other side of the earth, under his feet, was the full moon. The moon and the fool, he thought desperately. Not good. But I can't stop now. A dog was barking a block or two away, in one of these alleys or parking lots. In spite of himself, Léon thought about the dog that appeared on the fool card in the tarot deck and the dogs that in Greek mythology accompanied Artemis, the goddess of the moon. And, of course, the picture on the moon card generally showed rain falling. He wished he were allowed to get drunk. We'd better be heading for home, Scotty, he told the boy, keeping the urgency out of his voice only with some effort. Get this done, he thought. Palm fronds rattled overhead and threw big drops down onto the pavement. Home? Protested Scotty. No, you said guilt, made Léon gruff. You got a fancy breakfast and lunch, and you've got a pocketful of punched chips and flattened pennies. They took a few more steps along the puddled pavement toward Center Street, where they'd be turning right toward the bungalow. The wet street smelled like dry white wine. I'll tell you what, though, he said, despising himself for making an empty promise. Tonight after dinner, this storm will have cleared up, and we can drive out of town with the telescope and look at the stars. The boy sighed. Okay, he said, trotting along to keep up with his father, his free hand rattling the defaced chips and pennies in his pocket. But it's going to be a full moon. That'll wash everything else out, won't it? God, shut up, Léon thought. No, he said, as though the universe might be listening and might do what he said. No, it won't change a thing. Léon had wanted an excuse to stop by the Flamingo Hotel, 7 miles outside of town on 91, so he had taken Scott there for breakfast. The Flamingo was a wide, three-story hotel with a fourth-floor penthouse, incongruously green against the tan desert that surrounded it. Palm trees had been trucked in to stand around the building, and this morning the sun had been glaring down from a clear sky, giving the vivid green lawn a look of defiance. Léon had let a valet park the car, and he and Scott had walked hand in hand along the strip of pavement to the front steps that led up to the casino door. Below the steps on the left side, behind a bush, Léon had long ago punched a hole in the stucco and scratched some symbols around it. This morning he crouched at the foot of the steps to tie his shoe, and he took a package from his coat pocket and leaned forward and pitched it into the hole.
"Another thing that might hurt you, Daddy?"
Scott asked in a whisper. The boy was peering over his shoulder at the crude rayed suns and stick figures that grooved the stucco and flaked the green paint. Leon stood up. He stared down at his son, wondering why he had ever confided this to the boy. Not that it mattered now.
"Right, Scotto," he said. "And what is it?"
"Our secret."
"Right again. You hungry?"
"As a bedbug."
This had somehow become one of their bits of standard dialogue.
"Let's go."
The desert sun had been shining in through the windows, glittering off the little copper skillets the fried eggs and kippered herrings were served in. Their breakfast had been on the house, even though they weren't guests, because Leon was known to have been a business associate of Ben Siegel, the founder. Already the waitresses felt free to refer openly to the man as Bugsy Siegel. That had been the first thing that had made Leon uneasy, eating at the expense of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.